Late afternoon, June the 11th, 1999. I'm back in Christchurch at the start of another year of covering the All Blacks. I've been climbing ladders like this all over the rugby world for over 30 years. In my early days, I leapt up here three at a time. When I started commentating the All Blacks, Ian Kirkpatrick was All Black captain, and there have been 15 Test captains since. I reckon I've seen more All Black rugby than any man alive, and it still looks as good as ever. The 1999 All Blacks are the latest in a long line which stretches back to the beginning of the century. These young men have some huge boots to fill. The expectation of New Zealand as a nation have always ridden on our men in black. There's one place which is very special to me in the All Black rugby story. I'm often asked which was the proudest day I've had as a rugby commentator. For me, it was here at St Helens Ground in Swansea in Wales in 1982. I was here as part of the touring media covering the New Zealand Maori tour of Wales. And we came to this ground for the game against Swansea. Also here was George Nepia, back in Wales for the first time in 58 years as part of a Maori supporters group. And I went to get George to bring him to halfway to interview him about the game he'd played here when the All Blacks toured in 1924. And as I walked with George, I could hear people whispering in the crowd, "There's George Nepia, there's George Nepia." And at halfway, the applause had gone right round the ground. And George, 78 years of age, was pushed out under the halfway mark to take a bow from the crowd, and he came back into a rapturous ovation. People here knew they'd seen the greatest All Black of all time. Like every kid growing up in the 1950s, I too dreamed of wearing the silver fern just like George Nepia. That's me in the number four jersey as a 19-year-old playing for the Wellington Football Club's Senior B team. There I am, sorting out number 20. I was never going to be an All Black. That was obvious even then. My rugby career ended as a pretty average lock forward in the Wellington Football Club's Senior B team back in 1967. But as a commentator, I've been very lucky. Since 1974, I've toured right around the world with the All Blacks. In that time, I've met and interviewed most of the great players of the century. That's given me a tremendous insight into the culture of the All Blacks and the game of rugby right from its origins. One of the great myths of rugby was that it was invented here at rugby school in England back in 1823, when in the middle of a soccer match, a pupil, William Webb Ellis, picked up the ball and ran with it. As a result, the game is now called rugby, and in a few weeks, the first prize at the World Cup will be the Webb Ellis Cup. But it's all based on myth. What happened here was part of an evolution, not a revolution. Boys and men had been kicking and running with balls for centuries. But nevertheless, it's very much a British game. And here in Britain, it's based around the public schools like rugby. And it's here in Britain that our All Blacks story begins. In 1905, the very first New Zealand team to tour Britain was nothing like its upper-class opponents. Their captain was Dave Gallagher. His team became known as the Originals. Their first game in Britain was against Devonshire, one of England's top teams.
When the All Blacks turned up, they were greeted with a rather condescending welcome from the crowd. As far as they were concerned, it had been put in the press that this was just another bunch of colonials who were turning up to try and teach us how to play the game. Of course, the locals weren't all that pleased when that is exactly what they did.
When the All Blacks arrived, they went down to Devon and they practiced. And the mayor of Devon took one look at the practice and he said, "This team will never beat a British team. And they said, and why? And he said, none of them practicing their drop kicks. And in those days, drop kick was worth 4 points. So when they played at Devon, which was a championship side, the score was 55-4. Devon got their drop goal. But the All Blacks must have scored about 15 tries or something.
And the overwhelming victory was treated with disdain and disregard by the sage judges of the British media.
Well, it just wasn't believed. Most of the national press, who were only publishing the score, not an account of the game, reversed the score because they could not believe that a team that had been the champion county in recent years should lose by 50 points.
So the score was published as Devon and County 55, New Zealand 4.
Correct.
Another thing I find interesting is that the team wasn't yet known as the All Blacks.
Well, they certainly didn't have a nickname when they arrived. The local people called them the Zeals. That stuck to them for about half the tour. Luckily, somebody thought of something better.
It seems to be a journalistic slip, actually. J.A. Buttery from the Daily Mail referred to them as All Backs, and then because of the colour of the jersey, a sub at the Daily Mail probably thought, it can't be All Backs, they must be All Blacks.
So, in fact, it remains unclear as to where the name All Blacks was first attached to a New Zealand rugby team playing here in Britain. Maybe it was when the players responded to reporters' questions when they got off the boat in Plymouth, or maybe it was here when the public first saw the colour of the team's jersey. Perhaps it was even in those newspaper reports later in the tour. But one thing is clear here in Exeter. The influence of the 1905 All Blacks and the colour of the uniform lives on today in the club.
Devon left their shirts behind or lost them travelling here. So they had to turn out in the Exeter strip, which was white with a black stripe across it. The Exeter team was sitting in the stand, and the first thing they said to the committee afterwards was, we're never playing those colours again. So they changed. And surprise, surprise, they changed to all black. And they played in all black for the last 90 years.
The 1905 All Blacks were sensational. They played 35 matches. They lost only once. On every count, it was a triumph. Yet what do we Kiwis remember, and what are we still disputing? The one we lost. And that loss set the scene for one of the greatest rivalries in our rugby history, New Zealand versus Wales.
In the whole of this century, whenever New Zealand and Welsh rugby is talked about, there's always one incident that stands out above all others, the Bob Deans try.
In the test against Wales at Cardiff, Bob Deans lunged over the line to score. The All Blacks were trailing 3-0. The Deans try would have equaled the score and the easy conversion would have put us into the lead. But the Welsh that day performed the equivalent of the underarm bowl. As soon as Deans had scored the try, two Welsh players, one of them Rhys Gabe, pulled him back, a move not seen by the referee, who was wearing street clothes and struggling to keep up.
The Deans try, which we in New Zealand say should have been awarded, started an argument which has gone on down the years. All the people who were there that day at Cardiff Arms Park have long since gone, but the argument goes on.
On my mother's knee, I learnt not nursery rhymes or the Welsh national anthem, I suppose, but the fact that Deans did not score at Cardiff in 1905, that Rhys Gabe tackled him.
I guess the family's angle was that he clearly scored it, and if Bob says he scored it, then that was the way it was.
That's because the family understood his word to be impeccable.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, they believed he wouldn't contemplate lying, basically.
The All Blacks came home as heroes. Their tumultuous reception was recorded in one of the first films ever shot in this country. That loss to Wales was not to be forgotten, but it was to be another 18 years before the All Blacks were to return and avenge the injustice.
Kentucky.
Heaven in paradise.
The real.
1924, the All Blacks were to play 32 games, including tests against England, Ireland, Scotland and Wales. And it was the game against Wales they anticipated most keenly. The disallowed Dean's try and that 3-0 victory to Wales back in 1905 still festered. And when, in the Welsh test, the full-time whistle blew, 50,000 Welshmen knew they'd been thrashed 19-0, a point for every year we'd waited since New Zealand had been robbed of the Dean's try. The tour came just 6 years after the trauma of World War I. If New Zealand's national identity was forged on the battlefields of Europe, this All Black team, in thrashing the mother country, also did more than its fair share in cutting the colonial apron strings. The new confidence in being a New Zealander was perhaps best summed up on the day they played England and Bert Cook was introduced to the future King of England.
He was introduced to the Prince of Wales, who was later King Edward VIII, and the Prince of Wales looked at Bert Cook, who wasn't a very big guy, and said, "Oh, you're not a very big chap for a rugby footballer." And Cook is said to have replied, "You're not so bloody big yourself."
And the enthusiastic way in which they played the game saw them literally run rings around the stuffy former public schoolboys they encountered. The English must have hated it. And I've often wondered if what happened just 8 minutes into the England game wasn't in some way a reflection of the antipathy the Northern Hemisphere had for the colonies. Cyril Brownlee was one of two brothers in the 1924 team. During an infamous incident in the game against England, the referee, a Welshman, Mr. Freethy, said that Cyril Brownlee had kicked a player lying on the ground. Brownlee protested his innocence. Not one Englishman admitted to being kicked. Nevertheless, the referee did the unthinkable. And for the first time, an All Black was sent off. The remaining 14 All Blacks went on to play like men possessed. And then came one of those moments of which legends are made. On the spot where Cyril had been chained, his brother Morris picked up the ball and scored one of the All Blacks' most famous tries. For me, this was a moment which helped set the standard that every All Black team will always rise above adversity and triumph. Okay. 88-year-old Eric Tindall is one of the oldest surviving All Blacks. Today, along with thousands of others, he's come to see the last All Black test on Wellington's Athletic Park, the ground he's been coming to since 1922. Not many have been talented enough to represent New Zealand at more than one sport, but Eric Tindall was such a man. A fine first 5'8" and a very good cricketer, Eric went on to become an international rugby referee and a test cricket umpire. This early trick photograph captures perfectly Eric's commitment to his sport. One famous day, he got married in the morning, played cricket for New Zealand in the afternoon, batting to save the game against the MCC at the Basin Reserve, then raced to board ship for England to spend 6 months away from his brand new bride playing cricket for his country. In 1935, Eric was again en route to Britain, this time with the All Blacks.
But we had the run of the decks for training purposes, and we had a rough scrum machine on board, and we had 6 footballs, which only lasted about 2 weeks, and all disappeared overboard, one after the other.
They intend to emulate the All Blacks of 1905, who lost only one match against Wales, and the 1924 side, which went clean through the tour without defeat, a great tradition to uphold.
Was that a difficulty for the team, that those great records were there, almost like hanging over your side?
Oh, it may have affected some, I don't know. We're well aware of the records of those before us, and if we didn't, the press are continually telling us about the 1905 All Blacks and how it was going, and how in the finish they told us how many tries we scored compared to the 24 and 1905 team, which is nowhere near like their figures.
Newton Abbott, the All Blacks, who have come over from New Zealand for a tour of Great Britain and Ireland, have started work and are putting in some pretty strenuous practice. They show remarkable speed, especially when it's remembered that they've had no field practice for 6 weeks.
Compared to some recent All Black sides, the 1935 team had tremendous success. They won 26 matches out of 30. But almost inevitably, along came the Welsh. With just minutes to go, the old enemy came from behind. A try was scored, and the Welsh squeaked through 13-12. 2 weeks later, that loss was compounded when the All Blacks were thrashed 13-0 by England. Our first ever test loss to the mother country.
Over he goes again.
It's been 64 years since Eric Tindall turned out for the All Blacks. To me, it's significant that when we put together a team of living All Black greats, as we did this year at Athletic Park, no one from his era was selected. In a sense, that's because the 1935 side as a whole seemed to have been discarded, forgotten by a public that since 1924 demands victory on every occasion.
So Wilson winner A, 77 matches, 32 tests.
Because of the Second World War, it would be 18 years before the All Blacks returned to Britain. The year was 1953. Once again, the focus was on the Welsh international.
Suddenly, Judd swooped on the ball and was over the line.
And you guessed it, Wales scored first. And despite the All Blacks having the best of the second half, the Welsh scored again in the final moments. Wales 13, All Blacks 8.
And that will live in the memory of kids and the old ones in the crowd. My father in the crowd, who's now with his maker, but he loved that. He loved the fact that his baby was playing against the big men of the world of rugby and winning the game.
13-8 it was. What a day for Wales.
The 1953 All Blacks went on to beat Ireland, England and Scotland. But when they got home, seven of the young men, including Sean Fitzpatrick's father, were unceremoniously dumped. They never wore the All Black jersey again. Such is the unforgiving culture of the All Blacks, a culture that could not and would not accept defeat.
All Blacks, who beat the All Blacks? Who beat the All Blacks but the good old Newport team?
It's been nearly 50 years since Wales last beat the All Blacks, but in that time, a couple of Welsh club sides have done it, and they're still celebrating.
Newport 3, All Blacks 0.
Greatest day of my life.
And it was. I'm not saying that. There's no acting in that. It was.
This is Rodney Parade in Newport in Wales, and it was here in 1963 that the All Blacks came and lost to Newport by 3-0. And that day, a young All Black took the blame from his senior teammates for the defeat. And 26 years later, that same All Black came with me back to this ground to act as co-commentator. And I took the opportunity to introduce that All Black to the man who'd kicked the winning goal for Newport in 1963. But the All Black didn't want to know. His name was Earl Curtin. Why didn't you want to meet him?
Oh, I just think that I don't think that I can't.
I said to him, you know, Dick Uzzell's next door. Why don't you go through and say hello to him? And he said, I don't want to go and speak to that man again. What do you think of that?
Well, probably Earl has got a long memory of the day that he will never forget.
It is a long time ago. Careers have come and gone. Today, Dick Uzzell, a retired bank manager, spends his days playing golf with the likes of his old Newport teammate, the great Welsh international Brian Price. But for them, and indeed for Earl Curtin, the game that day, way back in 1963, is indelibly seared into their memories, though for vastly different reasons. It was Earl Curtin's first match for the All Blacks. He was a nervous wreck.
And it was such a dull, dark day, and it was wet, and it was raining, and we didn't play particularly well, I don't think, as a team. But I was absolutely dreadful. No sleep. I actually believe that I didn't see the ball coming to me. I didn't see the ball leave Monkey Briscoe's hands at times with sheer hysteria almost, or psychological trauma in a sense, that I couldn't see it leave his hands.
The defining moment of the game was when the young Dick Uzzell dropped the goal to secure the only points of the match, giving Newport a 3-0 victory. Uzzell became a national hero. Earl Curtin became the All Black scapegoat.
So I became pretty much responsible for the loss. And even at the time, I sort of accepted that I probably did too, lose it for them. Probably the hardest thing, the saddest thing, was the oldies didn't speak to me.
The oldies and the
oldies? Oldies. Winneray did speak to me after the game and whatnot, but the others sort of just grunted and the thing. I was persona non gratis for a couple of days. I mean, they were grunting g'days in the morning and not a lot going on. But probably one of the saddest things was going home that night after losing. It turned out to be the only game on that tour out of 36. I was rooming with Bill Davis, which wasn't very pleasant that particular night either. Bill was at home and he couldn't believe, because it was actually his second game, but he couldn't believe that the All Blacks get beaten. I mean, he hadn't been brought up that way. They don't get beaten. And here he was at a half pipe crying into his pillow.
At the end of the tour, Earl Curtin was dropped. It was to take him 4 long years to claw his way back. But in 1967, when the All Blacks came together prior to the first test against England, Curtin was there and again scared witless.
I definitely had insomnia when the pressure went on. I remember getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I had to walk round Park Lane, because we stayed at the Park Lane Hotel. I walked round Park Lane in the middle of the night, and I walked round, and I never forget getting to the Hilton in the Park Lane. And I was going past the coffee shop window, and who should I see in there but my fellow colleague and prop who was going to play that day against England, Jazz Muller. Here's Jazz sitting there with his arms all akimbo, and he's eating a ginormous fee at 3 o'clock in the morning. And then I went in and I said, "Well, you're going to ask me the same thing. What are you doing here?" And to his eternal credit, he says, always get up in the middle of the night, and my mother leaves out a pound of steak, because I work at Friesen Weeks, you know, he says, and I have a steak and something in the middle of the night, because I can't get through the night without having another feed. I said, "You suffer from night starvation, dear Jazz." "Yep." No words, just "yep." So I sat there, and the great whale turned round, and we both waddled off back to the hotel after he'd finished his feed. And I'd had a cup of tea and a bit of toast, and we all went back to the hotel.
Within hours, Muller and Curtin were on the field. Curtin's nerves, which had let him down so badly at Newport, were finally on the side of the All Blacks.
A fearful fusillade of first half scoring. Number one, a try from dental student Curtin.
And so it had taken Earl Curtin 4 long years to get over the humiliation of Newport and get back into the All Blacks. 4 long years to win back the confidence of the All Black selectors. But what a triumph it was.
New Zealand's number 10, Curtin, the aspiring dentist, fills in another cavity.
Newport must have seemed a long way away at that moment.
Yes, it did. And I thought, "I've done you. I've beaten you." They say, "It's out of it. It's going to be part of history and I'll never forget it, but I've beaten you. You can do it. What I'm saying is any man, if he really goes, can do it if he wants to.
Now, I've often wondered whatever happened to Jazz Muller, the man with whom Earl Curtin shared that midnight feast. Jazz, a freezing worker from Eltham, had a terrific run as a test prop from 1967 to 1971. He held his own against the best of his era. But then he literally disappeared. This year, I tracked him down to his home in Taranaki, a home he's turned into a shrine to his glory days.
Wonderful room, Jazz.
Yes, not too bad, Keith, is it?
This is all the stuff you've kept all those years?
Over the 5 years, yeah.
Everything?
Yeah, yeah.
Everything you kept?
Yeah.
Towels, ties, badges, flags, what else?
Oh, a few odds and ends, I suppose, like old bottles and whatnot, eh?
What about meeting the Queen? That was a good day.
Yeah, wasn't too bad considering.
Not bad for a Taranaki lad
no.
And freezing works?
No.
What do you think of the modern game of rugby when you do see some of it?
Oh, it's a different kettle of fish now. Oh, yeah. It's not 67, 71, is it? It's easy as that.
So you'd rather play in your time than play in 1990s?
Well, it'd be like going through the training runs now. I reckon I'll be struggling the training runs. What do you think of it?
But
the skill.
You always struggle with the training runs.
You'd be dead right.
Isn't there a great... there's a great quote about you and Ivan Medanovich.
Yeah, dead right. Yeah.
Righto, quickly, straight drive.
Didn't you say... Listen, another training run. You have to use the matches to get fit for training.
Yeah, that'll be spot on.
Today, Jazz lives quietly. No television, no telephone, just a house full of great memories.
You choose to live quietly, privately?
Yeah, I'm like a hermit. Like a hermit in ways now.
What do you think of your time as the All Blacks? How do you remember it?
Well, it's good while you're there, isn't it? When you finish, you finish. It's name the game. So it's better been a... has been and never been, isn't it? But otherwise, you'd be nothing, wouldn't you, when you think of it?
And if you hadn't have been an All Black, what'd you have been?
Just ordinary... Brian Muller.
Scotland have played New Zealand a number of times. Scotland have never beaten the All Blacks, but there have been a couple of very exciting drawn matches. But perhaps the most dramatic match was here in the city of Edinburgh in November 1967.
Foot and mouth precautions as thousands of rugby fans walk into Murrayfield over disinfectant mats.
I was on a formal caution for... I don't think it was a line-out incident or something. Someone, a guy and I had a bit of a scuffle in the line-out.
But for the present, let's watch the game.
All Black legend Colin Meads played 55 tests. He had a reputation for being one of the hardest men in world rugby, a reputation well known on this day by the Scottish lock forward Earl Mitchell.
There was a bit of a hiatus and somebody was being attended to. And there was a line-out formed there and C.E. Meads was there and Earl Mitchell was there. And Colin spent some time in detail telling him precisely what he was going to do to Mitchell. And Mitchell in the dressing room afterwards was recounting this to the wide-eyed team, you see. And they said, oh, what did you say to him, Earl? He said, I told him to bugger off, but I have to say, I didn't say it in a very loud voice.
I think that every strong pack has to have one sort of tough guy that the opposition looks at and think, be careful about him. And I think Colin Meads had that about him.
Against Scotland at Murrayfield, Meads' reputation for vigorous play went before him. And not only were the players keeping a wary eye on him, so too was the Irish referee, Mr. Kelleher.
Referee Kevin Kelleher warns Colin Meads about dangerous play.
Unfortunately, I think that Kill and Tremaine and myself might have contributed to that, because I was having trouble at the back of the line-out with their captain, who kept pushing me every time, that, you know, and pulling me down when we threw the ball to the back. So I suggested to my friend Bunny that he might help me a little bit. You couldn't have two captains having a swing at one another. So we sort of dealt with this guy after warning him several times, and he sort of sneered at us each time. And Tremaine gave him one in the bread basket, you see, which knocked the wind out of his sails. So I turned around to see Tremaine, you know, about 25 metres away, and I had to go back and be sympathetic to the captain. Now, the referee, Mr. Keller here, hadn't seen what had happened and thought he'd lost a little bit of control.
That's Mitchell.
Then came a scene reminiscent of the Cyril Brownlee incident in 1925. Coming off a ruck, Meads lunges forward. It was obvious to the Scottish fly half Alex Hastie that Meads was simply going for the ball. But here was the great Colin Meads being sent off for the crime of kicking a player on the ground.
I was stunned, and who me, you know, and all this sort of thing. And it's one of shame and shock, and you don't know what to think. And the sequences after that was always things I could remember, you know, and in being in Scotland at Murrayfield. And I get in under the tunnel, but I couldn't get into the dressing room because it was all locked. And, you know, the baggage man couldn't get down in time to unlock the door. And I'm standing down there, and in comes a pipey that hadn't been watching the game, but he'd had a fair bit to drink, you know, he'd had a bit of the old Scotch stuff. And he said, because I had all this bandage on my head and from the test a couple of weeks before, a week before, in France. And he said, have you been hurt, me boy? And I was trying to tell him to bugger off politely. And, no, I haven't been hurt, and all those sort of things. And at the end, I had to tell him where to go, you know, sort of thing, because I was angry and savage and all those sort of things. And the whole thing was like that. But the team were tremendous, and I felt I'd let New Zealand down, I'd let family down, all those sort of things.
The 1967 team was tremendous in getting behind Colin Meads. It was a great example of All Black mates sticking together in the face of adversity. Yet occasionally our heroes do reveal feet of clay. I remember in particular the 1972 team. They were loathed by the British press, but for some reason they had a special dislike of the giant Otago prop, Keith Murdoch. Murdoch was seen by the press as a tough guy of a different sort.
Well, I don't think he should ever have been picked to play representative football. I think his nature was such that you'd want him on your side in a fight, but unfortunately, if you did have him on your side, you got into too many fights.
They had this thing that he was something different, and you know, they were going to get into him, and Keith was a guy that hated that sort of publicity. And they seemed to just have it in for Keith before he even started.
Now here's what a lot of the action is going to happen today. In the front row, interesting that Keith Murdoch is backing on the tight head side for New Zealand.
If Keith Murdoch was loathed even before he got onto the field, you can imagine how the Welsh felt about him when he went on to score this significant try.
New Zealand back there, and it could be a try for Keith Murdoch. And this massive 17 and a half stone prop forward Murdoch gets the try.
When Keith Murdoch came off the field that day, he was a hero. He'd scored the winning try in the All Blacks' victory over Wales by 19 points to 16. But what that game is most remembered for is not what happened on the field here at Cardiff Arms Park. It's what happened later that night across the street here in the Angel Hotel.
I think it was about 12:30, 1 o'clock, was hammering on the door, and went to the door, and here was old Keith. He had an Adidas bootlace on, and that was all. And, wanted us to come to a bit of a do and a party and...
Naked?
Yeah. With the bootlace.
What happened next is a matter of conjecture, But we do know Murdoch was drinking and he came down these stairs looking for more food and drink for himself and his teammates. His search took him into the hotel kitchen, where he got into an argument and then a fight with a security guard.
And what had happened, you know, we'd come together in our team room and Keith said, "I'll go down to the kitchen and get some food for us." The guy came in and grabbed hold of him. Well, I mean, that's a stupid thing to do. You don't grab hold of, any player. I mean, you talk reasonable to him and say, "Look, come on, guys, we know you've had a good win or whatever, but you're not allowed to be here."
Anyway, when Murdoch came out, he proceeded towards a dance hall, and that's where I lost sight of him. A few seconds after that, he appeared for a brief instant on my left, throwing a nice straight right blow into my side of my face, and this giving me the lovely shiner which I've got, you know.
Whatever the truth, Murdoch was out, banished from the team, shamed as no other All Black has ever been. He was escorted by the English rugby official, Mr. Stanley Couchman, all the way to London's Euston Station to begin the long journey home. Peter Bush was in London, heard of Murdoch's dismissal, raced to the station to take these dramatic pictures.
So this train arrived and Keith got out with this black blazer. Now, to this day, there was no fern on it. I don't know whether it had been, the suggestion was that it had been, the fern had been, that he'd cut it off. But anyhow, I think it might have just been a black blazer or a spare coat that he had. But Couchman was there and he got off with his head bowed, and there were TV backlights, front lights. There was, you know, it was the biggest media turnout that I'd seen in Britain. I fought my way in and kept shooting away, but he hardly looked up. In a bold move, I suppose, I said, "You don't have to leave, Keith." I said, "You know, you've got a 6-month visa like the rest of us have." And I said, "You can stay here." I said, you know, kind of quite flippantly, I said, "You could go and play league if you wanted to."
Keith Murdoch never came home. He disappeared off a plane during a stopover at Darwin. He vanished into the vast Australian outback and down the years has remained one of the most enigmatic figures of All Black history. But then in 1990, he was tracked down to a cane farm in northern Queensland where he was driving a bulldozer. He had little to say.
It's not going to be a long time, are you?
Even more than a quarter of a century later, Murdoch's expulsion from the All Blacks still haunts his 1972 teammates, in particular, his old captain.
I would now say that if he went, we all went, we'd all go. But it was just the way it was done at the time, and I, you know, that's probably one of my big regrets, that should have happened, you know, that if he goes, we go. And, you know, I've had to live with that, and sort of it's been difficult too. Even right up till today, when Keith Murdoch's name comes up, that always keeps coming back to me that, you know, that I was one of the people that mattered, that let him be sent home.
Fergie McCormick. In the long relationship with British rugby, what I find interesting is how extreme the rewards and punishments are for those who dare to put on the black jersey. Fergie's story illustrates the harsh realities of being an all-black asset one minute and a liability the next. There's a complete lack of sentimentality, and this simply sums up the old all-black ethos. That is the importance of winning, winning, and winning. My greatest memory of Fergie McCormick, the asset, was in 1969 with the arrival of the old foe Wales. At the time, Wales were the European champions with top players such as Barry John and Gareth Edwards. In the first test, Fergie contributed to the thrashing dished out that day with 3 goals. But it was here in the second test against Wales at Eden Park we saw Fergie at the top of his game. They were all there that day, Meads, Curtin, Lahore, Kirkpatrick, but it was to be Fergie's day. He was a star in a team full of stars.
Thank you.
He created a world record by scoring a total of 24 points in one test. There were three conversions, five penalties, and this amazing drop goal.
McCormick, it could be there. It's straight as it's got the length. It's there.
De Burgess now. McCormick to Hunter.
2 years later, a number of those Welshmen were back in the great British Lions team of 1971. The first test at Dunedin was to be a particularly sad day for the great Fergie McCormick.
Halfway in his own territory, Fulham's after him. Williams to McCormick. McCormick to Burgess. Over Carrington's head. And he's got it. Got it out.
British Isles 9, New Zealand 3.
It was sad in a way. Obviously, I had no sympathy at the time as a Lion. But to see the demise of Fergie McCormick, of Barry John actually toying with him, but then Barry John had toyed with a lot of superb players. And, of course, that day Fergie couldn't cope with Barry's precision kicking in the mud, which just teased him and tantalised him and exposed him, really, that maybe it was time to go. Whether or not you say, just like a fighter who had one fight too many, maybe that was the end. Well, it was indeed the end for Fergie.
I know they were very happy and very arrogant over their win, but that's life. Anyone who can beat the All Blacks in New Zealand would have to be arrogant and pretty happy about the win, I'd say.
And the Lions still live.
How did you hear that you were out of the All Blacks after all that time?
I had that feeling. Colin Meads was captain of that series. He said, I'll help you get in. You know, when you're an All Black and you're striving for your own place, you're not going to worry too much about your mate. But, you know, I had a feeling after that I'd go, and because the finger was really pointed at me that we lost and I was out of position, which I wasn't, things like that. And I had that feeling that the axe had fallen on me and that was it.
So how were you told?
Oh, I heard it, through the, when the sides read out. That's how I was told.
Just heard it on the radio, that yep. It was over?
Yeah, that's it. Bye-bye. as I say, you don't lose tests in New Zealand those days, I guess it.
Things not going McCormick's way to
To me, the unsentimental dumping of Fergie McCormick demonstrates yet again the unbelievable pressures the All Black tradition imposes on players. Every generation understands that winning is everything. And that pressure fell on a senior All Black on the tour of Britain in 1978. It was that year I came on my first trip to the British Isles with the All Blacks, a trip that I'll always associate with Andy Hayden. Like every All Black side since 1905, the game they most wanted to win was against their old rivals, Wales.
Bounce not quite good enough, Wales in the van. Ringer, step forward.
After just 8 minutes, reserve fullback Brian McKechnie came onto the field. He hadn't been expecting to play. He admits to being slightly hungover.
Now, Brian McKechnie came on as a replacement for Clive Curry.
If McKechnie had a bit part in what was to come, Andy Hayden was to be the star turn.
Andy Hayden there, he's had a good beginning, and I'm sure the All Blacks can win this game.
Winning meant everything to Hayden. He was prepared to do anything within the laws to win. The day before, Hayden and a few senior players had discussed using a device designed to trick the referee into awarding a penalty. With just moments to play, the All Blacks were trailing.
Loveridge.
They were desperate.
Murray, he wants it out. Just minutes remaining. The All Blacks, if they get any more possession, must pass the ball.
And I could see that the scoreboard wasn't favouring us. And in fact, at 12-10, with a minute to go, it didn't look good. It doesn't actually say in the rules that it's cheating. But it certainly was it was a variation on tactics.
What's the throw again? Is the gap better? My watch says 1 minute left.
Keep your eye on Hayden in the middle of the line-out.
Windsor. Holmes. Penalty, is it? Yes. Hayden was pushed out of the line-out.
Yes, I think that probably these days ethics have become a greater consideration. I think in terms of the actual act of Andy falling out of the line out while we actually believed that he'd had an inner ear infection and just lost his balance. I think the popular feeling was, and it was backed up by some film footage from an amateur video, was that the referee couldn't even see Andy when he left the line out.
Murray's right, and at the time I was wrong. This time keep your eye on Frank Oliver at the front of the line out. The penalty was awarded against Welsh lock Jeff Wheel for jumping off Oliver's shoulder. Not that I saw the Wheel infringement, and neither did most of the Welsh fans. They were just incensed by the Hayden Hollywood.
Let's hear how the crowd reacts to this one.
So at the ground, which had witnessed the disallowed Dean's try, the ignominy of the 1953 defeat, and the shaming of Keith Murdoch, it fell to the hungover Brian McKechnie to save the day for the All Blacks.
This could be the kick of the decade for Brian McKechnie.
And all I could think of was just get up there and take this as quick as you can. I was confident enough because I'd struck the ball quite well in that game. So, I was confident enough. I just didn't want to muck around with it.
And so here's McKechnie. It's handy enough. He's already landed one from there in this half.
And when I looked up and saw it was going pretty much dead centre, the arm in the air, and that was sort of relief.
McKechnie!
I think in terms of what Andy did, probably in reflection, Andy wouldn't do it again, and probably as a team we wouldn't have wanted it to have happened.
Unfortunately, even with the maturity of the last 30 years since the incident, I would do it again, unfortunately, because that's the way I think you do what you can within the rules to win. And that, in my mind, was within the rules, and I didn't want to go back to my dressing shed seat and sit there and say to myself, I knew I should have done that and we would have won the test.
Not only did they win the test, they went on to win the Grand Slam, also defeating England, Ireland and Scotland, all of them in the last moments of the game. Since 1905, when the All Blacks first came here to Britain, there have been many moments that have tested the relationship on both sides. We've hated them for the Dean's try, they've hated us for the Hayden dive. But despite this, the relationship between Britain and New Zealand survives, and I think in many ways it does so because of the character of the individuals who play the game that transcends race, class, triumph and heartbreak.
Down the years of All Black history, it's hard for some non-rugby people to understand the deep passion the game can generate. But out of the game have come some unlikely friendships. Take the case of 1967 All Black Ian McCrae and the man he marked in one game, Danny Hearn.
Up from the goalposts. Hopkinson and a try to McCrae.
Ian McCrae was a big, strong, running 5'8 from Hawke's Bay, not given to much emotion. There were no high fives in those days.
Reappearing in the New Zealand team this year after being out with an injury last year.
I was keyed up that day because McCrae was playing and I knew he'd be playing the week after, and I wanted to make a point to McCrae. I did make a point, as it turned out. That is, in the first tackle or the first time that he came at me, I was going to knock him into the stand so that he would then have a gentle game for the rest of that match, and then we would recommence the battle the week after. That was the idea. Well, that was my idea. I just slightly misjudged the tackle.
Out to Laidlaw, this is Herawini. McCrae, the big centre, out to Thorne. I think he took his eye off the ball. Budge Rogers trying to get his foot to it, can't. The ball bounces away from Nathan, number 16. And Danny Hearn, the county centre, they got a bit of a bump there.
Danny Hearn got more than a bump. He got his neck broken. That split second turned him into a paraplegic. And the tackle deeply affected the whole All Black team, but especially Ian McCrae.
You know, during our association since, he's just turned adversity into a strength, really. He just takes it so well and has carried on with a very full life.
And here is Danny Hearn this year. I visited him at Haileybury Public School north of London, where he teaches politics and coaches rugby.
You have any regrets about what's happened because of the game to you?
No, because there's no one having regrets, is there? I mean, what's happened has happened, and you've got to make... I mean, life is about making the most of what's on offer. And there's no good lying down and saying, feeling sorry for yourself. It's hopeless. So, regrets. I mean, obviously, I wouldn't wish it on anybody, but I wouldn't change anything.
Despite and even because of that terrible tackle in 1967, Danny Hearn and Ian McRae have become and remain good friends.
Yes, it's ironic, really. Probably of all the players that I've played against over the years, the association that I've kept up regularly is the one with Danny Hearn.
Soccer goals at each end. Many great moments of sporting endeavour have taken place in the name of Manchester United. Today it's the All Blacks against England. And it's going to be one of those standoff, eyeball to eyeball, All Black Parkers. I've been coming to Britain as a commentator for more than 20 years. The All Blacks have been coming here for nearly 100 years. Even in my time, I'm surprised by the ongoing differences I see between our two countries and how we regard this great game of rugby. To me, this was driven home in no uncertain terms as recently as this game in 1997. In the first test, we beat England 25-8. I was stunned at how they behaved, as was co-commentator and former All Black Grant Fox.
They're applauding themselves and they still lost. Forgive my cynicism.
The English took a lap of honour. I can't imagine an All Black team taking a lap of honour on any occasion.
The New Zealand team have headed to the dressing room. Richard Cockerell has got the England team in a parade up to halfway. And, you'd think they'd won the game. But let's look at the scoreboard. I'm sure it says 25-8 to New Zealand. Yeah, the music starts.
And I was staggered once again just 2 weeks later at Twickenham. This time England drew with the All Blacks. For the All Blacks, it was a crushing defeat. For the English, the draw was celebrated as a victory. For the English, if you haven't lost, you've won. For Kiwis, if you haven't won, you've lost.
They worked very, very hard and surprised all the pundits by holding this mighty All Black side to a draw.
The differences between Northern and Southern Hemisphere rugby that were all too apparent when the All Blacks first came in 1905 are still present today in the English countryside. The differences are deep-seated and cultural. Here, it's all Range Rovers, old public school ties, tweed and shooting sticks. From what I've seen, this exclusivity will always be English rugby's Achilles heel. This emphasis on class frustrates even those at the top of the English game.
Up here, I think there was a great desire for the game to be elitist and played by the right people. I talked to, and I won't mention his name, one of the people who used to run the game here. And I was talking about marketing the game and trying to get youngsters to play, and he said, yes, but Will, what you must remember is we don't want just anyone playing this game. And I looked at him, I just said, I just can't believe you say that kind of thing.
I can believe it, because every time I come to Twickenham, I see it with the eyes of an outsider.
Have a look at the picnic here. Have you seen those? There were oysters.
The English rugby fans are different. The game here is different. It's not inclusive. It remains exclusive. If the English regard rugby as an upper-class diversion, we're like the Welsh and regard the game of rugby as a national religion. And for that, we in New Zealand will always be stronger.
Gentlemen, thank you. Here's to an English win today.
England.
Thank you. And God bless the All Blacks.
In our search for legends of the All Blacks this year, I've come here to George Nipier's marae at Rangitukia on the east coast. For me, this was a special pilgrimage. I chose as my song of greeting the same one the Welsh sang to George and the Invincibles in 1924.
This land of song will still be singing with a love that never dies. We'll kiss away those tears of heroes when you come home again to Wales. Kia ora. Thank you very much.
I wanted to come here not just to pay homage to my hero, I also wanted to see what I think is the only public monument to an All Black legend. George Nipier's daughter, Kiwi Rowlands, took great pride in telling of her father.
Who were George's favourite All Blacks?
He always had a soft spot for the Brownlee, who was ordered off.
Then she took me to the gateway to her father's final resting place.
This is father, represented by the silver fern and the rugby ball.
The carving also acknowledges the support given to the great fullback by his wife.
We used to call her the real fullback because she stayed home, kept the fires going.
For me, the story of the All Blacks and their long relationship with Britain always comes back here to Rangitukia. The legendary 1924 Invincible George Nipier played and beat the Poms at their game, setting the standard for every All Black to come. New Zealand rugby embraces everyone, workers and bosses alike, Maori and Pakeha and Polynesian, rural and urban. George Nipier foreshadowed everything the All Black legend was to become. Because of the standards he set, the All Black legend lives on.
Legends of the All Blacks with Keith Quinn was proudly presented by Ford and Air New Zealand.